Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a free, complete course for the CCNA. If you like these videos, please subscribe to follow along with the series. Also, please like and leave a comment, and share the video to help spread this free series of videos. Thanks for your help. Also, remember to download this practice lab from the link in the description, and try it out yourself in Packet Tracer. If you want more labs like these, I highly recommend picking up a Boson's NetSim for the CCNA. Click the link in the video description to check it out. It's a network simulator like Packet Tracer, but it's even better, and it includes all of these guided labs to not only help you get hands-on practice configuring and troubleshooting, but also deepen your understanding of the exam topics. I used it myself when studying for my certifications, so I feel confident about recommending it to all of you. Watch until the end of this video. We'll take a quick look at a lab from NetSim. If you want to get your own copy of NetSim, please follow the link in the video description. In this lab, we'll analyze Rapid Spanning Tree Protocol, with a little bit of configuration at the end. I hope this lab will help you test and improve your understanding of the concepts of RSTP, such as the different port roles and link types. Let's get right into it with step one. First, we are asked which switch is the root bridge. Each switch has a priority of 32,769, which is 32,768 plus 1. So these numbers are all for VLAN 1. We will only be dealing with one VLAN in this lab. Of course, if there are multiple VLANs, the RSTP topology would probably be different in each VLAN, because we can choose a different root bridge, etc. for each VLAN. So because each switch has the same priority, we have to compare MAC addresses. Switch 1's MAC address is the lowest. Both switch 1's and switch 3's MAC addresses start with 000, but the next digit in switch 1's is 5, and in switch 3's it's C, which is equivalent to 12. So switch 1's is the lowest, and it's the root bridge. Now let's examine the port role and state of each interface on switch 1, and see what's different than what we have learned so far about the root bridge. Enter privileged exec mode with enable. Next, show spanning tree. Okay, F02, F01, and F024 are designated ports in a forwarding state, and F03 is a backup port in a discarding state, although it's written as blocking in the output of this command. I'm going to take these labels I have made and place them over the interfaces. So what is different than what we have learned about the root bridge in the course? Well, I have repeated multiple times that all interfaces on the root bridge are designated ports. However, in this case, F03 is a backup port. So actually, the more accurate statement is that the root bridge has a designated port in each collision domain it is connected to. In modern networks, hubs aren't really used, so we usually just say that all interfaces are designated. However, if the root bridge has two interfaces in the same collision domain, because they both connect to the same hub, the rule that there must be only one designated port per collision domain applies, and the other interface will be a backup port. If this was classic spanning tree, F03 would be a non-designated port. So that's step one. Although I have said many times that every interface on the root bridge is designated, in this case, F03 isn't, because it's in the same collision domain as F02. Step 2 asks us to determine the port role and state of each remaining switch interface, without using the CLI. First, let's place the root ports. Switch 2's root port is F01, with a root cost of 19. How about switch 3's root port? Does this hub add any spanning tree cost to the BPDU? No, it doesn't, so switch 3's F02 also has a cost of 19, making it the root port of switch 3. Switch 4's interfaces have the same root cost, so which neighbor has the lowest bridge ID? It's switch 3, because its MAC address is lower, so switch 4's F01 interface is its root port. Next up, the designated ports. Switch 3's F01, across from switch 4's root port, is designated, of course. Now, for the gigabit Ethernet link between switch 2 and switch 3, which side will be designated? They both have the same root cost, 19, but switch 3 has the lower bridge ID, so its G01 will be the designated port. How about between switch 2 and switch 4? In this case, switch 2 has the lower root cost, so its F02 will be designated. So switch 2's G01 and switch 4's F02 will be alternate ports in a discarding state. These ports connected to the end hosts should all be designated ports, by the way. I won't bother labeling them. Now let's quickly confirm on each switch. We already saw switch 1, so I'll go on switch 2. Enable. Show spanning tree. F01 is the root, F02 is designated, G01 is alternate, and F023 and 24 are designated. Looks good. Next, I'll check on switch 3. Enable. Show spanning tree. F02 is the root port, G01 is designated, and so is F01. F024, connected to the PC, is also designated, just as we expected. Finally, I'll go on switch 4. Enable. Show spanning tree. F01 is the root port, F02 is alternate, and F024 is designated. Okay, looks like we got it all correct. Finally, let's manually configure the appropriate RSTP link type on each interface. The one I really want to show is switch 1's F024. So let's quickly go through the others, starting here on switch 4 first. Conf T. Let's configure F01 and 2 as point-to-point links, because they are directly connected to switches. They are operating in full duplex mode. Interface range, F01 to 2. Spanning tree link type, point-to-point. Next, I'll configure F024 as an edge port by enabling portfast. Interface F024, spanning tree portfast. Now let's check. Do show spanning tree. Okay, F01 and 2 are point-to-point, which is correct. Actually, they were already point-to-point by default. I just wanted to practice the manual configuration. Now, what's up with F024? It still has the default type of point-to-point. Well, this is something I didn't explain in the lecture. Edge ports connected to an end host like this will still be point-to-point links if they're using full duplex. There is no hub here. Therefore, the link is full duplex, so this is a point-to-point link. However, it's also an edge port. It doesn't work in Packet Tracer, but if you enter the spanning tree portfast command on a port on a real switch, it will display both edge and point-to-point here in the type section. Point-to-point means it is full duplex. Edge means portfast is enabled. So it's both an edge port and a point-to-point port. Okay, let's do switch 3 next. F01 and G01 should be point-to-point. However, F02 is connected to a hub. It should be a shared port. Actually, let's check before we configure it. Show spanning tree. As you can see, the switch automatically sets it to the correct port type. So really, the only one we have to configure is F024, because portfast won't be enabled by default. For the sake of time, let's just do that. Conf T, interface F024, spanning tree portfast. Okay, next let's go on switch 2. Let's check first again. All ports are using full duplex, so they should all be point-to-point by default. Show spanning tree. Indeed, all ports are point-to-point. Again, for time, I'll just enable portfast on F023 and 24. Conf T, interface range, F023 to 24. Spanning tree, portfast. Okay, finally switch 1. In this case, it has 3 ports connected to a hub. These should all be shared by default. Only F01 should be point-to-point. Let's check. Show spanning tree. As expected, F02, 3, and 24 are shared. So F024 is connected to a hub, but there are end hosts connected to the hub. Should this be an edge port? The answer is yes. The hub basically doesn't exist in terms of spanning tree. It's different than if it were connected to a switch here. So F024 is an edge port and a shared port, just like I explained with the edge point-to-point links connected to end hosts on the other switches. Let's configure it. Conf T, interface F024. Spanning tree port fast. And let's check. Do show spanning tree. Okay, so just like before, in Packet Tracer it doesn't display here, but on a real switch it will display both edge and shared here in the type column for F024. Point-to-point and shared distinguish between full and half duplex, but either can be an edge port as well. Okay, that's all for this lab. I hope this helped you get familiar with some concepts of RSTP. Next, let's take a look at a lab in Boson NetSim. Okay, for today's Boson NetSim lab preview, we're once again doing a lab from NetSim for CCNP Encore. I said this before, but that's because spanning tree configuration isn't actually in the CCNA exam topics list, so Boson doesn't include it in NetSim for CCNA. But I just want to show you one of the spanning tree labs they have from NetSim for Encore. So we'll do spanning tree 1. I've already loaded the lab, so click on lab instructions. Here is the topology. So there is one router and three switches and two PCs. Here's a list of the commands you need to know to complete the lab, IP addresses on the device, and the lab tasks themselves. So this lab demonstrates something I really like about Boson NetSim. Although this is a lab focused on spanning tree, the title is Spanning Tree 1, you don't only configure spanning tree. Task 1 is configure VLANs, so you'll be configuring trunk ports, creating VLANs, adding interfaces to VLANs as access ports. Task 2 is configure the router, so configure the interface with .1Q encapsulation for VLAN 3, verify connectivity, and then finally, task 3 is observe spanning tree. So I think this is great because you not only get to practice the new things you're studying, but also review things you've already studied in the past, which is very important, of course. So let's just do task 1. This isn't actually about spanning tree, but let's review some VLAN configuration. So verify that the current IP configurations on PC1 and PC2 match the IP configurations listed in the IP addresses table. Here's the table, PC1 and PC2. They are in the same subnet. They should have the same default gateway, 192.168.100.1. PC1 is .101, PC2 is .102. Let's check. So to get to the CLI of these PCs, click on them here and click console. All right, so I have PC1 and PC2. Let's check PC1 first. How do you check the IP address on a PC, or a Windows PC at least? That is IP config. Okay, IP address .101 looks good, /24 mask, and the default gateway is .1. Okay, PC1 is good. PC2, IP config, .102, /24, default gateway is .1. Okay, so both PC1 and PC2 have the correct configuration. Task 2, verify the connectivity by pinging from PC1 to PC2. The ping should succeed. Okay, let's try. Ping 192.168.100.102. Okay, looks good. The ping goes through. Okay, so step 3, configure switch 1 with the appropriate host name. Okay, so I'll open up the CLI of switch 1, enable conf-t hostname switch 1. There we go, the hostname has changed. Next, configure fast Ethernet ports 0, 1, 2, and 3 as trunk ports, and create VLAN 3. Okay, switch 1 is here. Okay, so all three of these are trunk ports, or we will make them trunk ports. And we have to manually create VLAN 3 because we're not actually assigning any access ports to VLAN 3. It won't be manually, it won't be automatically created for us. So we have to do it ourselves. So first, let's make those trunk ports. Interface range, F01 to 3. Now, I don't know if on this switch model I have to configure the trunk encapsulation, .1Q or ISL. Let's just try to set it to a trunk first. Okay, we don't. So this switch only supports .1Q trunk encapsulation, which is actually common on most switches these days. Okay, next, right, create VLAN 3. VLAN 3, exit, and let's check that it was created. Do show VLAN brief. And it was, there's VLAN 3. Okay, what's next? Configure switch 2 with the appropriate host name. Create VLAN 3. Add fast Ethernet port 4 to VLAN 3. And then fast Ethernet ports 1 and 2. You must configure them as trunk ports. Okay. So, fast Ethernet 4, VLAN 3. So I'm going to just assign fast Ethernet 4 to VLAN 3. And then VLAN 3 should be automatically created for us. Switch port access VLAN 3. Was it? Do show. Oh. I am on switch 1 at the moment. That's the problem. So we do not need this configuration. I'll just know that. Cancel that. So let's go into the CLI of switch 2. And let's try that again. Conf T. All right. First the host name. Host name switch 2. No space, switch 2. Interface fast Ethernet 04. Switch port access VLAN 3. Was VLAN 3 created? Yes, it was. Okay, so VLAN 3 was created and fast Ethernet 04 is now in VLAN 3. Okay, next let's make these two interfaces trunk ports. Interface range F01 to 2. Switch port, mode, trunk. Okay. So I'm guessing the next step is switch 3. Let's see. Okay, configure switch 3 with the appropriate host name, VLAN 3, add fast Ethernet 04 to VLAN 3, and configure fast Ethernet 01 and 03 as trunk ports. And then try another ping from PC1 to PC2. Okay. So first, I will assign this interface to VLAN 3. Let's open the CLI of switch 3. Enable conf T interface F04 switch port access VLAN 3. Let's check that it was created. Do show VLAN brief. And it was. Okay. Next. So this time, it's not fast Ethernet 01 and 02. It's 01 and 03. So I have to enter the interface range command a little differently. Interface range F01, comma, F03. Now I'm in. If I did like I did before, 01203, that would include fast Ethernet 02, which we don't have to configure now. Okay, switch port, mode, trunk. Okay, so now all of these interfaces between the routers, they're all trunks. These are trunk links. The interface going to the router is a trunk also. And both of these PCs are now in VLAN 3. So the ping should go through. Let's try once again. And it works. Okay. So that's task 1. As we saw before, task 2, you would configure the router. And then task 3, you would observe what's going on with spanning tree. So when you have completed the lab, I haven't, but we'll end the lab anyway. You can check your work using the grading function. So that's this button here. Click on it, and it evaluates how you did on the lab. So as you can see, I missed one or more commands in the lab. That's because we didn't finish it. However, notice switch 1 has a check mark. So we did all of the configuration on switch 1 correctly. These three interfaces are trunks, and VLAN 3 was created. If you ever have any trouble during the lab, you can check the lab solutions down here. It gives you sample outputs, shows you all of the commands you need to do, and gives you some detailed explanations like this. So I really think Boson's NetSim is a great resource when studying for your CCNA. If you want to get a copy, please follow the link in the video description. I highly recommend it. I used it for my certifications, and it really is a great tool.
Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to the channel, like the video, leave a comment, and share the video with anyone else studying for the CCNA. If you want to leave a tip, check the links in the description. I'm also a Brave verified publisher and accept BAT or Basic Attention Token tips via the Brave browser. That's all for now.